tonight I would like to deal with the subject of who is Jesus Christ. For Christ is the central issue of the Christian faith. He is the one in whom we trust for our eternal life, our Savior and our Lord. And the first objection that I would like to deal with is this one. Don't you know that Jesus is just a myth? It's all just a fable made up by some people, and it never really happened at all. By the way, you will notice that our text tonight in 2 Peter 1:16 says this, "For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty." The word cunningly devised fable, the word fable there is the Greek word mouthos, from which we get directly the word myth. A myth or fable, something existing only in the imagination, something not historically true. The historical evidence is so overwhelming that there is virtually no historian today that would say that. Now, what shall we say, since the majority of you have had that issue raised to you? I think that there's some things that you would like to be able to say. And the first one I would say, well, that's a very interesting opinion. I suppose you know that there is virtually no historian in the world today that would put his reputation on the line by stating that, because the evidence for the existence of Christ is so overwhelming that they wouldn't dare do it. Did you know that? No, they didn't know that. But that is true. And there is great evidence, and I think that we might just take a look at what some of that evidence is. First of all, let me mention the obvious. There is the evidence that exists in the Scriptures, in both the prophecies of the Old Testament and the life of Christ as it is presented to us in the 27 books of the New Testament. Keep in mind that the New Testament is a collection of 27 books, and the Bible is a collection of 66 books, and they have been gathered together. It's a library. So right off immediately, you can think of 27 books written in the first century that talk about Christ. And that certainly is truly remarkable, and none of them indicate that he is mythological. In fact, on the other hand, they emphasize very strongly that they have not made known cunningly devised fables or myths, but they were eyewitnesses of his majesty. They listened to him talk, they saw him, they handled him with their hands, they ate meals with him, and they knew him very, very well. He was by no means to them a myth. Now some will say, well, we can't accept the Bible as being true. Well, before we grant that, let me point out to you what one of the greatest experts has said about that, and that is Simon Greenleaf, Professor Simon Greenleaf. And I hope, if you don't know his testimony, that you will. I hope you'll jot down some notes to remind you of him. He is one of these people, he's just one of these huge axes that you can just take to the root of an unbeliever when they come arguing with you. Greenleaf, in his day, and he lived through the latter half and of the 19th century and into the 20th century, was the Royal Professor of Law at Harvard. He was declared to be the greatest expert on evidence that the world had ever known. Now, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court said that Greenleaf's testimony is the most basic and compelling testimony that can be accepted in any English-speaking court in the world. When Greenleaf spoke, on legal evidences, that settled the matter. He was far and away the most knowledgeable person on evidence that the world had ever known. The London Times said that more light on jurisprudence had come from Greenleaf than from all the jurists of Europe combined. Now, Greenleaf had one, as some of you know, had one inviolable principle in his classrooms at Harvard. And that was, you never make up your mind about any significant matter without first considering the evidence. And Greenleaf was not a Christian. He was, in fact, a Jew. He did not believe in Christianity. He did not believe in Christ. He did not believe in the resurrection. And one day, the subject of religion came up, as it often did. You should remember that law is based upon ethics, and ethics and morals are based upon religion. And they were discussing religion and the resurrection of Christ when he made the statement he didn't believe in the resurrection of Christ. And one student with some degree of boldness raised his hand and said, "Yes, but Professor, have you considered the evidence?" No, he had not. He was aghast. He had lost enough face to depopulate China. He decided to make such an investigation, and he investigated every single thread of evidence on Christ and the resurrection of Christ in particular, and he finally wrote a book, which I was perusing this afternoon, again, entitled The Testimony of the Evangelists, being Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And he concluded that if the question of the resurrection of Christ and the evidence for the resurrection of Christ were presented to any unbiased jury in the world, they would have to conclude that Jesus of Nazareth actually rose from the dead. And Simon Greenleaf became a believer in the resurrection. He became a believer in Christ. And in fact, I was noticing one sentence in his book that I thought was interesting. Here is a man who is a complete disbeliever in the resurrection or the miraculous or Christianity or Christ or anything, and now by the time he's writing this book, he says, "In requiring this candor and simplicity of mind in those who would investigate the truth of our religion." And that just struck me. Boy, there's a man that has definitely been one all the way. Tooth and claw, he has been brought in. And so he sees that Christianity is, in fact, the only evidential historical religion in the world, and that the whole thing rests upon evidence. Evidence which he finds is so compelling and so overwhelming that any honest person with an open mind examining the evidence would, like himself, be inescapably drawn to accept it. And he sets forth his first rule, a rule, by the way, of legal evidence concerning the Bible or any other ancient document. Listen to this. Every document, apparently ancient, coming from the proper repository or custody, and bearing on its face no evident marks of forgery, the law presumes to be genuine and devolves on the opposing party the burden of proving it to be otherwise. And then he goes on to say that this ancient document, the scripture, has come from the proper repository. That is, it has been in the hands and the persons of the church for 2,000 years almost, and it bears on its face no evident marks of forgery, and therefore the law presumes it to be genuine, and those that would presume otherwise, upon them devolves the responsibility of proving it to be false. We don't have to prove it to be true. They have to prove it to be false. That's what the law says. And he goes on to give a number of other rules of law and of evidence, all of which support the scriptures.